Namaste to all of you. It's wonderful to be with so many like-minded sadhus today. Can you hear me? Am I?
Yes, madam. Yes. Audible? Yes, yes, yes.
Yeah, thank you so much. Janaki Ramji, thank you for your wonderful, affectionate words. I thank Sajani, Ravi, Ram, Beena, all the people who are in charge of organizing this program for giving me this wonderful opportunity to share the great words of wisdom of Sri Ramana Maharshi through the composition called Upadesha Saram. So during this session, we will have a presentation also going on side by side. In the presentation, I have tried to give in a few photographs of Bhagwan Ramana Maharshi's birthplace, his parents. We also have the shlokas of Upadesha Saram in Sanskrit and English. So we may first want to look at the purpose. You know, whenever we start something, we need a purpose, we need a goal. Why are we going to do this? What is the use of doing this? What is the benefit of doing this? So what is the benefit of studying something like Upadesha Saram composed by Sri Ramana Maharshi? If we ask ourselves that question, I would say that every day of our lives, we keep on undertaking so many actions. Can you see the presentation? Is the presentation visible to all of you?
Yes.
Yeah, thank you. So, as we were saying, every day from the time we get up till the time we go to bed, we are engaged in action. One kind of action or the other. It may be mundane actions like maybe just getting up, brushing your teeth, having a bath, eating breakfast. Or it may be more important things or what we think is more important, like going to our workplace or cooking for all the members of our family. So one thing or another, we are always engaged in. If we ask ourselves a question, what is the purpose of every action? From morning till night, we perform so many actions. What is the purpose of each action? We may say, each action has a different purpose. How can you ask such a general question? But Vedanta says, Bhagwan Ramana Maharshi says, behind each action, ultimately, there is only one purpose. One purpose behind each and every action that we perform. And what is that one purpose? When we sip a cup of coffee in the morning, we sip it because it gives us pleasure. It gives us happiness. When we go to work, we go because we need to earn maybe, or because we get joy out of working. And then from our earning, what are we going to do? We are going to buy different things. So the things that we buy are going to give us happiness. We have friends. We have family members with whom we like to spend time. Spending time with them gives us happiness. So ultimately, any action that we undertake in life, for whatever purpose, even the action of helping others without expecting any kind of monetary return or any kind of exchange from them. That also we do because it gives us joy. So every single thing we do, ultimately, if you keep on asking why, so what, you come to one single purpose for each action, and that is to get happiness. So when we get happiness from doing something, what the scriptures are telling us is, in your entire day of 24 hours, you get a few drops of happiness. Every now and then, like a drop of nectar, you get a drop of happiness from an action that you have undertaken either today or many days before, or maybe many years ago. It may be bearing fruit today. But there are also drops of frustration, drops of anger, drops of irritation, drops of bitterness, drops of sorrow, drops of boredom. So each moment can bring us many different things, and some moments can bring us happiness. But Bhagwan Ramana Maharshi and Vedanta, they tell us, you are happiness. You yourself are happiness. The only problem is you haven't realized it. So by studying Upadesha Saram, what we will get is the ability to be in bliss all the time. Through the study of Upadesha Saram, by contemplating what we have studied, by practicing what we understood in our day-to-day lives, instead of getting just a few drops of happiness here and there, it is possible for every human being, for every sadhak, for every seeker, to be established permanently in happiness that does not wax and wane depending upon the outward circumstances. External situations will no longer have the power to disrupt this bliss or happiness, which we are. We don't get it, but we are this bliss. So that is the purpose, the ultimate purpose of studying something like Upadesha Saram. And just before we begin, actually, let us chant the Guru Mantra, Gurur Brahma, Gurur Vishnu, and Asato Ma Sat Kamaya, lead me from untruth to truth, with our audio on mute. Please join me as we chant together. Om Gurur Brahma, Gurur Vishnu, Gurur Devo Maheshwarah, Gurur Sakshat Parabrahma, Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. Asato Ma Sadgamaya, Tamaso Ma Jyotirgamaya, Mrityorma Amritam Gamaya. Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. Let us offer our pranams to Bhagwan Sri Ramana Maharshi and all the great masters of wisdom who illumine our paths. May their grace and blessings shower down upon us in great abundance and light the lamp of awareness within us. So as we look at the slide of Bhagwan Ramana Maharshi, just looking at his face, at his eyes, we see so much compassion, karuna, And his whole life, he devoted only to propagate wisdom, to help people to see what is the true nature of their self. And he did his best to establish all those who came to him in the self or in Ananda. Slide change. So, what is so great about Bhagwan? He was born in 1879. He took Mahasamadhi in 1950. Now we are in 2020. So even 70 years after he took Mahasamadhi, after he left this earthly planet, why are thousands of people all over the world still so focused on his teachings? Why is Thiruvannamalai teeming with people? Why are people all over the world saying, who am I, based on the teachings of self-enquiry by Bhagwan? So before we begin on the composition itself, I know many of you will be familiar with the life story of Bhagwan, but still, let us recall a few incidents so that we know the master before we begin on his composition. We know the Ramayana, we know the Mahabharata, but still, we enjoy listening to these stories again. We enjoy watching these serials again. So we may know it or we may not know it, but let us recall the story of the master with devotion, all of us together. Now, in 1879, like I said, Bhagwan Sri Ramana Maharshi, who was actually named Venkat Raman, he was born in Tamil Nadu, in the small village called Tiruchuli. So, Tiruchuli in this slide, if you see, we have, this is the house, the styled small building, is the house where Bhagwan Sri Ramana Maharshi was born. It has now been taken over by the ashram and it is being maintained so that people who want can go there, they can sit inside and meditate also. So in this small house, Venkat Raman was born. He was born on December 30th and in the night around 1 a.m. when he was born, at that time, a temple festival, you can see over here, I put in the Bhuminatha Swami temple in Tiruchuli, the temple of Shiva. So in this temple, a yearly festival was going on. And this festival was called Arudra Darshan, where the Utsav Murti of Shiva is taken out in a procession around the village. And then the chariot was re-entered the temple precincts, and the Utsav Murti was being taken into the Sanctum Sanctorum. It is said that at that very moment, Sri Ramana Maharshi was born. When he was born, in the puja room of the house, there was a midwife, a person who was helping with the labor of Alagammal, who was his mother. And this midwife was actually blind. She had been blind from birth. But she said, as soon as the baby was born and I held him in my hands, there was a wonderful flash of light that I saw. She had never seen light in her life. She said, that was the first time that I saw this flash of light. And I knew that this baby would be a great sage. So Venkat Raman was born, and his father, Sundaram Iyer, whom we also see in the picture. This is Sundaram Iyer. This is Alagammal. Sundaram Iyer was a lawyer. He was very, very beloved by all the people in the village because he was helpful. And half of his house was set aside for guests. We must remember that in those days, there was no concept of having a hotel or a guest house or anywhere. So if anybody came to the village and they didn't have a family to stay with, they needed accommodation, then Sundaresh Iyer's house was always available. Sundaram Iyer's house was always available. So half the house functioned like a guest house where people would come and stay, and Alagammal would cook and serve people day and night. So this was the kind of household into which Venkatraman was born. And we hear that up till the age of 12, when he lived here in Tiruchuli, Venkatraman was a very normal boy, in fact, a mischievous boy, because he engaged in a lot of pranks. He was very athletic. He played games, and they called him Tangakkai. Tangakkai means the golden hand or the winning hand. He always won in every game. So many of his friends had a grudge against him. They would lose to him in swimming or football or wrestling, and they would have a grudge against him. But because he was very strong, they couldn't do anything. They couldn't beat him up. But one strange thing that Bhagwan himself has mentioned, he says, in my childhood, I used to go into very, very, very deep sleep. Now, all of us do sleep deeply. But when Ramana Maharshi went to sleep, when Venkatraman went to sleep, nobody could wake him up. Practically no one could wake him up. So his friends would come and they would carry him out of the house, beat him up, bring him back and put him on the bed again, and he wouldn't have woken up. In the morning, the satisfaction that they got from beating him up was very much diminished, because when he woke up, he said, "Oh, did you do that to me? I really don't know. I'm not aware of it at all." So they didn't get the satisfaction of him accepting that he had been beaten up. So this was this kind of very deep sleep was a recognized phenomenon during his childhood. When Venkatraman was around 12 years, his father passed away. His father was in his 40s at that time, not an age where you would think that someone would die. But in his 40s, suddenly his father passed away. And when his father passed away, Venkatraman's family had to split up. His father had two brothers. So to one brother's house, his mother and his younger brother and sister, they went there. Venkatraman and his elder brother, Nagaswami, they went to another uncle's house in Madurai. So in this slide, you actually see the Meenakshi temple here in Madurai. And this house that you see, which is again now acquired by the Ramanashram and being maintained, this is the house of his uncle, where actually Bhagwan Sri Ramana Maharshi got enlightened. So in Madurai, life continued much the same. Venkatraman was going to school, and his brother was in college. Both of them were studying. And this went on. Then suddenly, one day, when Venkatraman was around 16 years, between 16 and 17 years, he was in the first floor house of his uncle. He's sitting there, and he's studying English grammar. He has an assignment. He's sitting and studying. All of a sudden, for no apparent reason at all, he got this great fear. It was a panic. I am going to die now. He says, I was in perfect health. There was nothing wrong with me. But out of the blue came this gripping fear, overwhelming fear that I was going to die. At that very moment, I was going to die. He says, I didn't even think of going to a doctor or talking to my brother or going down and talking to one of the elders of my family. This didn't occur to me at all. I just thought, let me see what happens if I die now. So I lay down on the ground. Venkatraman lay down on the ground and he held his breath and he said, now my breathing has stopped. Now my body has become very stiff. I can't move my limbs. This body is dead. It will be taken to the burial ground and it will be burnt, it will be cremated. So now am I dead? He says, suddenly in a flash, not in words, but in an intuitive flash, experiential moment, I understood that I am not this body, I am not the mind, I am not the intellect, I am the self which exists always. It has been existing before this moment, right now it exists, it will always continue to exist. I am this immortal self. I am bliss. And that moment, this whole experience physically took about half an hour, but he was beyond time and space, and Venkatraman all of a sudden had changed completely inside. Outside, he was still the 16-year-old boy. He still had to go to school. He still had to interact with his family members and his friends. But inside, he was changed forever. So he says, for about 6 weeks, he continued to go to school, but somehow not really interested in what was happening outside. But he became suddenly very quiet. He didn't interact much with his friends. He would come home, open a book, sit for hours without writing or reading, completely absorbed in his bliss. So this went on for about 6 weeks, where he didn't tell anybody that he had gone through this experience, because he himself didn't understand what had happened. He had never studied Vedanta. Just about a few months before, he had read the Periya Puranam that gives the story of 64 Shaivite saints. That was the first inkling he had that it is possible for somebody to get liberation or mukti. Otherwise, he was not into rituals. He had not studied philosophy. He was not exposed to Vedanta. He knew nothing about this kind of state. All of a sudden, he had been catapulted into it. So he tried to continue with his regular life for about 6 weeks. In this kind of state, one day he's sitting and he has his book open in front of him. He's supposed to do an assignment. He doesn't feel like doing anything because the inner bliss is overpowering. So he just sits cross-legged and closes his eyes and gives himself up to the bliss. His elder brother comes into the room and he says, what is the use of all these books for such a one like you? He means it very sarcastically. Oh, you're a big saint. You'll sit with your eyes closed and meditate and pretend that you're very pious, but what you need to do is actually be studying. But this one sentence, what is the use of all this for one like you, suddenly turns the mind of Venkatraman. He realizes the futility of this kind of external life, and he decides that he must go to Arunachala. Now, a few months or a year before this enlightenment happened, Venkatraman had met a visitor who had come to his uncle's house, a relative. And when he spoke to the relative and asked him, from where have you come, sir? This person, the visitor, he said, I have come from Arunachala. This very name Arunachala made every hair on the body of Ramana stand up. Romanchana happened to him. And he said, Arunachala? Does something like Arunachala actually exist? And this relative said, of course, it is in Tiruvannamalai. So Bhagwan says, even before I heard this word Arunachala, from a very young age, from ever since I can remember, there was this vibration in my heart, inner heart. It doesn't mean the physical heart. There was this vibration in my inner heart. And this vibration kept on reminding me of Arunachala. I never knew what is Arunachala, I never knew there is something called Arunachala on earth. But this vibration within me kept on resonating of Arunachala. So this resonance suddenly had been confirmed by this relative who told Ramana that he had come from Arunachala. So when his brother came into the room and he very sarcastically said, "What is the use of something like this for such a one like you?" Suddenly, Venkatraman felt the call of Arunachala become very strong. He decided, "I will go to Arunachala." So he closed his book and he told his brother, "I have a special class in school." This was the very last lie he told in his life, he says. So he said, "I have a special class in school, brother. I have to go there." And his brother said, "Okay, if you're going to school, on the way, pay my college fees. Take 5 rupees from auntie, pay my college fees." So Bhagwan went down, his aunt served him food, he ate food, and he took 5 rupees, and he took an old railway guide. He looked up how to go to Tiruvannamalai, and he saw the fare, it said 3 rupees. So he left 2 rupees, he took 3 rupees, and he wrote a letter. He said, "This," suddenly he has no individuality. He's not able to say "I." He says, "This has gone away in search of the father by his command. And there is no need to search for this. This has gone for an auspicious purpose. Please do not waste. No money or time may be wasted in searching for this." And he said, "P.S. school college fees has not been paid. 3 rupees have been taken." And he had to sign. Suddenly, he could not sign also, because there is nobody to sign. There is nobody called Venkatraman anymore. So he just drew a blank, a straight line below the letter, and he went. He went to the railway station after several hardships, several adventures, into which we will not go right now. He went to Tiruvannamalai. So when he went to Tiruvannamalai, he went to the temple, and if you have gone to the Tiruvannamalai temple, you will remember it is a very huge temple. It's a very big temple complex, and there are many subsidiary temples and the main shrines. So he had to pass through many gates, but at the time that he went there, every single gate is open, every single door is open. So he is going straight to the shrine of Arunachaleshwara, where the linga is there. Even the Garbhagriha door is open, the sanctum sanctorum, the door is open. There is no priest inside at the time. He just rushes in and he embraces the linga and he says, "Father, I have come. Father, I have come." And he says, "Till that moment, there was a great burning in my body. Ever since I had the experience of enlightenment, I understood my true nature. My whole body was burning terribly. But the moment I went and I embraced that linga, my whole body became very cool." So he went to Tiruvannamalai and he stayed in various spots in the temple all the time, just with his eyes closed, immersed in bliss. He didn't talk to anybody. He didn't try to get any food. He didn't. The minute he got after the darshan, a barber asked him, "Shall I cut your hair?" So he got his hair completely cut. He tore off his dhoti and took a small cord piece and wore it like a loincloth. And he went and sat. He says, "I was not doing any sadhana. I was not doing any tapas. All that was over. I was already established in bliss. But because the experience was new to him, he was so immersed in the bliss and he was enjoying it so much. He didn't feel like talking to anybody. He was oblivious of the body. He didn't take care of any needs of the body." He says, "I never bathed for about 6 months. I didn't bathe till somebody forcibly gave me a bath. So he was sitting. Initially, other small boys, boys of his own age, they would come and try to force him to come and play with them. But when he didn't come, they would throw stones at him. So he said, it became very difficult for me to sit in the 1,000-pillared hall where I went and sat initially because it was very open. And when boys threw stones at me, they would come and hit me. So he went into a cave-like underground temple. If you go there now, you can still see the Patala Lingam. He went and he sat there. During those days, nobody else would go to the Patala Lingam because it was dark and dingy and damp and full of insects and scorpions. So it gave him a shelter where boys could not come and trouble him. So he went and sat in the Patala Lingam. And he was sitting there for days together, months together. It is said that his thighs were so much bitten by insects. There were deep bites which got filled with pus and blood. But still, it didn't bother him. He was immersed in the internal bliss. Somebody found him. Suddenly, two, three people became attendants. They came and fed him. Otherwise, he would not even have survived because he was not bothered about getting food. So like this, his life went on. After a few years, after shifting to various different temples, he started slowly talking to people. And many people came to him one by one, initially a few people, but slowly, as his fame built up more and more, thousands of people flocked to him. So this is the story of his enlightenment. If we look at after the story of his enlightenment, now here we see, this is the first ever photograph taken of Bhagwan Sri Ramana Maharshi. It was taken in 1902, that is 6 years after he came to Tiruvannamalai. We also see the Tiruvannamalai temple there. When he was like this, I will come back to a little bit later about how his family searched for him and they found him, etc. Now I would like to go on to how the Upadesha Saram was written, these 30 shlokas. Within the first 15 shlokas, Bhagwan gives a roadmap for Karma Yoga, Bhakti Yoga, Raja Yoga, control of the mind. And then in the next 15 shlokas, Bhagwan gives us a roadmap for Jnana Yoga and Atma Vichara or self-enquiry. So how did these 30 shlokas get written? Here in this slide, we see on the right-hand side, a person sitting at the table and writing. Now this is Muruganar. Bhagwan had many, many devotees, some of them very well known, like Muruganar and Kavya Kanta Ganapati Muni, and some of them very, very humble, but all of them were ardently devoted to Bhagwan. So this Muruganar, whom we see here, he is a very famous Tamil poet, and he could sit and write poetry very, very easily and fluently. He was a great devotee of Bhagwan. He had left his home and come, and he was staying permanently in the ashram. He had devoted himself to Bhagwan. Later in some other session, we will also look at the story of Muruganar and his wife Meenakshi. But for now, Muruganar was sitting one day and he was writing a poem. So this poem was about there is a legend that comes in the Shiva Purana where Lord Shiva comes as a mendicant, as an ascetic, to Darukavana. Darukavana is a forest. He comes to this forest because there are so many ascetics there. They were actually dwarf ascetics, a tribe of ascetics and their wives, who were engaged in rituals continuously from morning till night. They were engaged in rituals. And through these rituals, they had acquired a lot of supernatural powers. So using these powers, they performed all kinds of, you can say, magic or paranormal phenomena. And they thought the only purpose of sadhana or penance or rituals was to keep on acquiring paranormal powers. So it is said in the Shiva Purana that Lord Shiva took pity on these ascetics. He said, they are so dedicated, they are so devoted. From morning till night, they're engaged in these kind of rituals. But their very orientation is wrong. Their orientation should be mukti. It should be liberation from sorrow, from impermanence. They should do all this in order to get centered in the changeless one. But instead, they're going on, focusing on getting siddhis. So I will help them, he decided. And Lord Shiva, we can see here, he came as a mendicant. It is said that he was very handsome. And with him, he brought Vishnu also in the form of Mohini. We see her here. She was also very beautiful. So when they came into the Dharukavana and they saw these ascetics, it is said that all the ascetics fell in love with Mohini, Vishnu, who was very enchanting, and he used his powers to enchant them. And all the wives of the ascetics, they fell in love with Lord Shiva, who was a mendicant, and he was very handsome. So wherever he went, all the wives started following him. Now wherever Mohini went, the ascetics followed her. At a certain point, Mohini completely vanished. She disappeared. And suddenly, the ascetics realized that their wives are not with them. So they went searching for the wives and they found the wives surrounding the mendicant. They became very angry. And using their paranormal powers, they started bombarding Lord Shiva with serpents, with lions, with tigers, with thunderbolts, all kinds of natural phenomena. Lions manifested. Lions that were not there manifested. Thunderbolts that were not there were manifested. But each time when a serpent came, Lord Shiva would just take it and put it around his neck very casually. When a lion or a tiger came, he would very easily slaughter it. And he also started using paranormal phenomena to combat this, their siddhis. So one thunderbolt, 10 thunderbolts would come from Lord Shiva. So whatever these ascetics did, they used their utmost siddhis. They could not even there was not a single scratch on Lord Shiva at the end of it. Finally, they surrendered. They said, we thought you were just a normal mendicant, but now we understand that you must be some divine being. We have spent decades of penance to acquire these siddhis. But you have come and you have shown us much greater siddhis than ours. So, oh mendicant, why don't you teach us? Show us what sadhana you did, what sadhana we need to do to acquire the kind of phenomena or the ability to perform your kind of siddhis. Can you please show us that? So Lord Shiva said, what is the use of siddhis? You can manifest lions, you can manifest tigers, you can manifest thunderbolts. But what is the use of siddhis ultimately? Are they giving you happiness? Are they giving you joy? Are you happy all the time? And the ascetic said, no. How can we say that we are happy all the time? We are definitely not happy. There are many, many times when we are unhappy. So Lord Shiva said, give up all your rituals. Give up your desire to acquire more and more siddhis. I will teach you sadhana, which will take you to mukti, which will liberate you from sorrow, which will establish you in bliss. And this is the point to where Muruganar, remember, Muruganar was the poet who was a disciple of Bhagwan Sri Ramana Maharshi, who was writing a poem on this legend. So up to this point, Muruganar has written his poem, and all of a sudden, his pen can't write anymore. It stops. And he wonders, why is it? Why has poetry dried up within me? Why can't I get the next line? And then he said suddenly, it is because only Bhagwan Ramana Maharshi, who is my Sadguru, only he is eligible to complete this poem for me. Only he can write down what Lord Shiva told the ascetics. What is the secret of getting permanent happiness? Only he can write. Because Muruganar believed, like many of his devotees at that time, that Ramana Maharshi was the very embodiment of Lord Shiva himself. So Muruganar went to Bhagwan and he said, Bhagwan, only you can complete this poem for me. Please write the Upadesha of Lord Shiva. What did Lord Shiva tell the mendicants? And that is how Bhagwan sat down and composed 30 shlokas. And in Tamil first, because Muruganar's poem was in Tamil. Muruganar was a Tamilian, Bhagwan was a Tamilian. So he wrote in Tamil, and those 30 shlokas in Tamil were called Upadesha Undiyar. Later, Bhagwan Ramana Maharshi himself translated these 30 shlokas into Sanskrit and he called them Upadesha Saram. Upadesha means teaching. Saram means essence. So Upadesha Saram contained the essence of Bhagwan Sri Ramana Maharshi's teachings. And since Ramana Maharshi's entire enlightenment experience and all his self-inquiry, everything is based on Vedanta, it also contains the quintessence of Vedanta itself. So with this kind of introduction, let us move on to the composition itself. So I will change the slide. You can see the first shloka of the composition. I have written the shloka in Sanskrit for those of you who are comfortable in Sanskrit. I have also written the shloka in English. So in English phonetics, the phonetics in which the shloka has been written, wherever you get capital letters, capital alphabets, it means that there is an elongation of the vowel. Instead of a, it will be a. So instead of e, it will be e. You have to elongate over there. Or if it is a consonant, it will be in Mahaprana. That means instead of p, it will be p. Instead of t, it will be t. Instead of d, it will be d. So that is how we read this. I will chant the shloka, first line of the shloka, keeping your audio on mute. Please repeat after me. And then I will chant the second line. You can repeat that. Then we will chant the shloka together, both lines together.
Karturagnyaya prapyate phalam. Karturagnyaya prapyate phalam. Karma kim param karma tajjadam. Karma kim param karma tajjadam.
Together, both lines.
Karturagnyaya prapyate phalam. Karma kim param karma tajjadam.
So kartuhu. Kartuhu means creator. The one who has created entire creation. Kartuhu. Agnaya. Agnya means command or will. By the command of the creator, by the will of the creator, kartur agnyaya. prapyate. Prapyate means we get. What we get is prapyate. Phalam, the fruit. Karma kim param, karma tat jadam. Karma kim, kim means how. Param, supreme. How can any action be supreme? Because every action is jadam, inert, unconscious, insentient. So Bhagwan is saying here, the phalam or the fruit of every action comes back to us. Whatever we have performed at any time, in any birth, or even yesterday, day before yesterday, today, every action has a fruit. And that fruit will come back to us. Even in the Bible, Jesus Christ says, as you sow, so you reap. If you plant a mango seed, you will get a mango plant. If you plant a neem seed, you will get a neem plant. So whatever seed we sow, we get the same kind of fruit. So karturajnaya, by the will of the creator. What has the creator said? Whatever action you perform, you will reap the fruit of your own action. Karma kim param, how can any action be supreme? Because every action is inert. Now this may not make complete sense to us, so we need to dig a little deeper into this, into the meaning of this shloka. For example, let us say that we have a mixer. In the morning when we are cooking, or we want to make dosas, or whatever we want to make, we need to grind the masala or the dough in the mixer. Now we put everything into the mixer, we put on the switch, and the mixer grinds. Is the mixer grinding on its own? Can the mixer grind on its own? Is it possible for the mixer to grind on its own? What is required for the mixer to grind whatever we put into it, into a fine paste or into juice or a milkshake? Electricity is required, right? So without the presence of electricity, a mixer cannot grind. Without the presence of electricity, a fan cannot give us breeze. A bulb cannot give us light. So Bhagwan is saying here, Ramana Maharshi is saying, now this body, this mind, this intellect, without the presence of the self, they cannot function. If somebody dies, somebody for whom we have a lot of regard, a lot of affection, whom we love a lot, a friend or a relative, when that person dies, just 5 minutes before, that person may have been talking to us. The person may have been doing something, drinking coffee, eating. Suddenly of heart failure, we have seen people, no? Now they are fine, next minute they are gone. So 1 minute before, they were eating, they were drinking, they were talking, they were walking. The very next moment, the body is there, the legs that were walking are there, but they can't walk anymore. The hands that were working are there, they can't work anymore. The brain that was thinking is there, but it can't think anymore. The mouth that was talking is there, cannot talk. Ears cannot hear, eyes cannot see. Everything is present. The form is present. But it cannot do anything. It is lifeless. It is a corpse. We say Shiva becomes Shava. In Kannada we say Shiva aktane Shava. So Shiva becomes Shava. That means only the presence of the self within the body, mind and intellect can power it. Just like electricity can power a gadget, like a light bulb or a fan or a mixer or a grinder or whatever it may be. Like that, unless this self, this Chaitanya, this Chetana, this ever-present energy, consciousness, unless it can power the instruments called the body, mind and intellect, these cannot function, these are inert. But we forget that. We forget it, don't we? I also forget. What do? Through the day, we say, when the body does something, we say, I did it. Mind comes up with a good idea, oh, it was my idea. Intellect makes a good decision, oh, it was my decision. But in actuality, all these instruments are inert. They're able to function. They're able to come up with outputs only because there is a powering force. There is an unseen force that is powering them. So anything that comes out of something that is inert is also inert. This is what Bhagavan is saying. Your three instruments are inert. Body, mind and intellect are inert unless they are powered by the presence of the self. They cannot function. Body will keep functioning until the hardware gives out. So when the hardware gives out, the heart cannot beat or the lungs cannot breathe or the brain is unable to link up. When something goes wrong with the body, it disconnects. So it disconnects and we say the body is dead. So when this disconnect happens, suddenly we realize these are all inert. Without the energy of the self, nothing happens. That is why there is a Sanskrit proverb. Trinamapi na chalati te navina. Without your will, even a blade of grass cannot move. So Bhagavan is saying, it is the ordination or the command or the law of the creator of this entire universe. Think of the orderliness in the entire universe. The galaxies, the stars, the planets, the human beings, the plants, everything in so much of order. Every day on the streets, we have so many accidents, but since decades, so many planets, so many galaxies, so many stars are going on rotating, revolving, and hardly any cosmic catastrophes happen. So in this entire orderly universe, the creator of this orderly universe has certain laws. And one of the laws, the important law for us is, as you sow, so you reap. So whatever you do, whatever action you perform, that action will come back to you. Its fruit will come back to you at some point of time. It may be immediately or it may be a little later. It may be in this lifetime or it may be in some other lifetime. But what is very definite about it is that fruit will come back to us at some point of time. But if you think, like the ascetic's thought, if you think that action itself is supreme, action is the answer to everything, then Bhagavan is saying, remember that action is inert. It is not the answer to everything. How can we understand this? Think of a child. A child has just come back from school. Child will take off his or her shoes. She comes in, sits down in the living room, is sitting very quiet, not doing anything, just sitting. After about 5 minutes of this, the mother or father will come and they'll tell the child, come on, get up. What are you doing sitting like this? You're wasting time. Go to your room, change your clothes, wash your hands and feet, come and eat a snack. Don't you have homework today? What has happened? The child came home and the child was sitting quietly, not doing anything, just sitting quietly. What do you want the child to do? What does the parent want the child to do? Parent wants the child to get into a mode of action. So, from morning till night, every day, we are giving so much importance to action. Without action, we think nothing can be achieved. Get into a mode of action for everything. Here, Bhagavan is not saying that action should be shunned. Action should not be performed. No. But action is not the primary way of resolving anything, of solving anything. We have the type, we all of us, we are called human beings. But we have forgotten the being part. We are all the time doing. We can call ourselves human doings. We give more importance to doing things rather than to the state of being within us. So even in an action, three instruments, body, mind, intellect, all of them will engage together in an action. Isn't it? We need the mind, we need the intellect, we need the body. All of them have to be in alignment when we perform any action. So whatever karmic fruit we are going to get will depend upon the attitude taken up by each one of these instruments. So suppose I'm doing cooking in the morning. Now, because of the COVID situation, many of us who used to have cooks are doing the cooking ourselves. Who used to have help at home are doing the sweeping and mopping and dishwashing, etc. So let us say I am in my kitchen, I am cooking, but I am feeling very frustrated. Oh, what is this? Every day I have to cook. Nobody in my house will come and help me. They're all doing their own things. I also have lots of other work to do. I have to go on site visits. I have to go and finish drawings for some projects. But I have to do cooking also every day. I have to make breakfast for 6 people, 7 people, 2 people, 3 people, whatever the case may be. So my mind is not benevolent towards the task that I'm performing. My mind is resisting. My intellect is saying, how does it matter? Just finish. Doesn't matter if the taste is not so good. Doesn't matter if the food is not appreciated by anybody. Anyway, nobody compliments you on the food that you make. Just finish quickly. And the body is making the food. So can we see the dichotomy that is happening? The body is making good food, but the mind is doing it with anger, with resentment. The intellect wants to be done with it, does not want perfection or the food to be great or anything. So three different things are happening within three instruments. So for what the body is doing, you will get a good fruit because that is going to help other people. It will give them food to eat. It will sustain them. It will nurture them, nourish them. But the mind is pumping anger. It's going on being angry, resentful. So the mind will get the fruit of resentment. At some other time in life, a negative fruit will come because of the resentment. And the intellect is taking wrong decisions. It is saying it is not important if the food is tasting good. It is not important if the food is not relished by other people. So the intellect will again get unpleasant fruits. So there is a mixed bag of karma here. So with everything that happens, now think of another scenario. Somebody is cooking. My friend is cooking. She is cooking with love. whatever I cook, let it bring good health to others, let it bring peace to others, let it bring happiness to others. And the intellect is saying, cook nicely, cook well, take care, let them be happy with this food. And the body is cooking the food. So here, body, mind, intellect, all of them are aligned. So you will get good karmic fruits for the body, good karmic fruits for the mind, good karmic fruits for the intellect. So every action can either generate integral fruits, fruits that are integrated, aligned, of the same kind, or they can generate a mixed kind of karma, or they can generate something that is totally unpleasant. Body is also doing things wrong, not washing things properly, cooking unclean food, not cooking the vegetables correctly, half-cooked vegetables, too much oil, so body is cooking badly. Mind is having anger, intellect does not want to do it. Completely a unpleasant karma is getting generated. So by generating karma through action, if we are always believing that action is the only solution, what is important is the state of being inside. So when we do some action, if the state of being is calm, if it is peaceful, if it is happy, if it is benevolent, then the action has a different kind of impact. But if the internal state of being is angry, is resentful, it is jealous, it is bored, it is depressed, then you have a different, that action will have a different kind of impact. It will bring in a different kind of fruit. So whatever is the action, don't look only at physical action. Look at kaya, vacha, manasa. What you do, what you speak, what you think, what you feel, what you decide. The ideal that you have in front of you. So Dr. Annie Besant, who was the international president of the Theosophical Society, she was also a great freedom fighter and a social worker. She was a clairvoyant, and she said that if physically, whatever you do, if you have a relative scale between physical, mental, emotional, intellectual, ideal, etc., she said for a physical act, for a good physical act, you will get plus one. For a bad physical act, you will get minus one. For a good emotional thought, emotion or thought, you will get plus 5 or plus 10 compared to 1 for physical action, or minus 5 or minus 10. And if you have a strong ideal, the right kind of ideal, you will get plus 125. And a wrong ideal, the kind of ideal that Hitler had, you will get minus 125. This is for every action. And it's a relative scale. Don't look at it as marks. Just relatively saying, an ideal is 125 times more powerful in the karmic fruit category than a physical action. This also makes sense because physical action can result in some things which we, without any intention behind it. We are walking on the road, we step on an insect and the insect dies. But we didn't know that insect existed there. We were walking, it was there without seeing I stepped on it. So I get minus one physical karma. That means some kind of discomfort will come to me. Physical discomfort of a small order. Because I didn't intentionally kill the ant. But if I intentionally kill the ant or the insect, then I will get the one of the physical karma, 10 of the mental karma, 125 of the ideal karma, etc. So it is a what we perform. More than the physical action, the internal state of being is important. So in our life, actually, that is why it is said in the morning, start with meditation, start with puja, start with some kind of state of being where we sit and we get into a state of being before we start doing. So being is more important than doing. That is very strongly set out in this shloka. So for time, I think we are at 7:13. Maybe I can stop here and invite questions. We will of course continue with this, and Karma Yoga goes on into several other shlokas. What should be the attitude, etc. We will be taking up from the next session. So another thing is having a strong sense of doership. I am doing this action. If I have that sense of doership, definitely that will generate karma for me. If I do things without a sense of doership, even if I remember that there is a long chain of causation, that means in order to make something like a cup of coffee for a visitor, my friend comes, I'm making a cup of coffee for my friend, then I need milk. Milk has to come from a cow, that has to be milked by somebody, that has to be pasteurized by somebody, it has to be packaged by somebody, it has to be brought in a truck to the vendor, and that vendor will bring it to my house. And I need a vessel, that vessel has to be made by somebody. So there is a big chain of causation, a cosmic chain of causation for every action, which we forget. And finally, we make the coffee and we say, I made the coffee. So even this chain of causation is something which we should keep in mind when we are doing things. Physically, there is a big chain of causation. And before taking credit for something and saying, I did it, because this is an instrument, without the self being present, this body, mind, intellect can do nothing. And if I take ownership for my deed, I will get a mixed bag of karma depending upon the intention, the emotion, the thought, and the action. So if you have any questions, you can unmute and ask the question, or you can even
stop sharing. Allay the
camera. Any books for reference? Yeah, there are plenty of books for reference. Upadesha Saram itself, you can download. There are many free versions that you can download from the internet. Also, you can go to Ramanashram website, official website of Ramanashram, and you will find that you can click on the bookstore. And from the bookstore, you can order books. For a good biography of Sri Ramana Maharshi, you can maybe order or borrow Ramana and the Path of Self-Knowledge, written by Arthur Osborne. Ramana and the Path of Self-Knowledge by Arthur Osborne. You can start with that. I think more, if you start with that, what kind of reading material are you looking for? Could we get some more reading material recommended is the question I'm getting here from Mahalia Shetty. On the life of Bhagavan or teachings of Bhagavan? Teachings of Bhagavan, you can also look at Who Am I? That was the very first thing that he ever wrote that came out in book form. It has 24 questions where Bhagwan answers on how to do self-inquiry. So you can also look up Who Am I by Bhagwan Sri Ramana Maharshi. There are a lot of books. So I'm glad I joined. The first Sara itself is so deep and I want to listen to the rest soon. Thank you. Teachings of Bhagwan. So teachings of Bhagwan, you can buy a book from the bookshop that says all the compositions of Bhagwan. It contains all his compositions. We are right now doing Upadesha Saram, but we have also something called Sat Darshanam, that is 40 verses on reality. So this is also available. Then there are several other compositions of Bhagwan. So you can, if you order complete works of Bhagwan from the bookstore, Ashram bookstore, you would be able to get all his works. And teachings, actually, we have a wonderful legacy of teachings of Bhagwan, because all his devotees, many of his devotees, have given us accounts of what used to happen in the ashram, of the dialogues that went on. So we have a lot of literature on Ramana. So depending on, after looking at some of these, depending on your area of interest, you can start ordering other books. I think a recording is being done. That's what I was told. So it will be available for listening again. Even on the very first shloka, there is more which we have to talk about. But if I start that now, I will not be able to finish it. So from the next session, that is next Saturday. It is every Saturday. This session will be every Saturday from 6 to 7:30. And it's wonderful having all of you here in this exploration today. So every Saturday, 6 to 7:30, we will be taking up this Upadesha Saram as a series till we complete all the shlokas. Hopefully, Sajani is asking me how many sessions will be there. It depends on the depth we go into and how many questions we get, etc. Right now, I would say maybe 15 to 20. 15 at the least and 20 at the most. Any other questions?
Which two shlokas can be taken per day?
So I think if we don't have any other questions, I would like to offer whatever we have done at the Lotus Feet of Bhagavan. We could do 5 minutes of meditation. Just close your eyes. Sit straight in a meditative posture. Close your eyes. Let us chant Om together, keeping your audio on mute. Please join me in chanting Om 3 times. Om. Become aware of your breathing. As your breath goes in and out, just be aware of it very gently, without great effort. Simply be aware of the breathing. There is no effort whatsoever. Watch your breath like you would sit next to a river and watch it flowing by. Be aware that this breathing is happening because of the power of the self. The self that you are. Your brain is functioning. Your heart is beating. Your body is working because of the self. Become aware of this presence in your body that is making it work. Be aware of the power in your brain, because of which you can think and feel. Feel this power pulsate in every cell of your body, through the body, in your head, your eyes, nose, mouth, ears, skin. Let us offer our gratitude and love to this wonderful power. Which is making this inert body, mind and intellect function every day for us. From now, every action that I perform, let me remember it is because of the self. I may forget many times, but every now and then, when my mind is free from other tasks, let me remember this wonderful self, which is my true nature, that is powering everything that I do. Let us offer our pranams to Bhagwan Sri Ramana Maharshi for the wonderful wisdom that he has given all of us today by chanting Om once again. Om. I thank each and every one of you for being a part of this satsang. Thank you.
Open mode. Audio, open mode.